Harrison Funk, Memories of Michael. June 25, 2018. Justice. Harrison Funk has captured the extraordinary life of the pop legend for almost 30 years. He recently shared stories of his favorite shots, from the singer's embrace with Nelson Mandela to Jackson's powder brush manipulation. "Michael and I had our own language," says Funk. "The key phrase was always the same. He asked me, 'Harrison, can you create something magical?' Nothing less was accepted." Funk was exactly the photographer who happened to be closer to Michael Jackson than anyone. He began working with the singer from the late 1970s and did not stop until his death in June 2009. He witnessed Jackson's multiple changes and was able to capture in photographs the process of the gradual transformation of an ordinary star into the most famous person on the planet. Funk was born 12 days before Jackson, on August 17, 1958, in a neighborhood bordering Brooklyn. He was inspired to take up photography by his uncle, Leo Friedman, a famous Broadway photographer. Funk began with street photography and local basketball games and gradually grew to commissions from magazines such as Time, Life, and Newsweek. But meeting Jackson at the infamous Studio 54 nightclub, where Jackson, as a regular, danced in the DJ booth to avoid autograph hunters, set Funk's career in a completely different direction. Impressed with Funk's professional versatility, Michael hired him as the Jackson's official tour photographer, Victory, in 1984. Funk claims that he very quickly saw and felt the entire media circus that had already begun to form around the singer. "Rupert Murdoch's people called and literally begged me to secretly take a photo of Michael for them during rehearsals. I told Michael about it and we laughed about it. However, the fact that I told him about it helped us build trust." Shortly thereafter, while traveling with the Jacksons, Funk gained unprecedented access to the singer. In one of the personal photos taken by Funk, Jackson puts on his own makeup, which he was incredibly proud of. "She and Jermaine love to put on their own makeup before performances," says the photographer, adding that Michael gradually became more and more interested in his appearance and, influenced by mentors such as Gene Kelly, Fred Astaire, and James Brown, sought to look at everything 100. Jackson's makeup process was also a sign of the singer's gender fluidity. On the part of Michael, it was not so much femininity as androgyny. He did not identify himself with any particular gender, and in general did not rank anyone. At that point, Funk recalls, Michael had never publicly defined himself as either a man or a woman. However, as soon as Jackson had children, he changed his image to father. "He became a strong man in that regard," adds Funk. On the Victory tour, Funk occasionally witnessed violent emotional outbursts. "Don't be fooled," he explains. "Michael could be extremely demanding. If he did not like something, he directly spoke about it. Michael never made fun of me, but if someone screwed up the stage design, he yelled at them. He expected perfection from everyone." The completely sold-out Victory tour was a watershed moment for Jackson. Just 2 years earlier, he had released Thriller to rave reviews on a cosmic scale, and the media hysteria unfolding around him was beginning to spiral out of control. However, some of Jackson's most iconic shots are not from his unchallenged reign in the 80s, but from the 90s, when the albums Dangerous and History marked the singer's transformation into a more socially conscious artist who could also touch on deep, serious themes. Black and White, and Acting Like a Fool, the Messiah Complex in Earth song caused such shock among the audience that Jarvis Cocker could not resist and jumped onto the stage during the 1996 Brit Awards ceremony. In one of Funk's favorite shots from this period, Jackson stands with his arms outstretched in an almost biblical pose. "People say that Michael had a Jesus complex," he says, "but that really pisses me off because it's complete nonsense. I took this picture for practical reasons. Michael had huge hands, and I wanted to get the most out of them because they were very expressive and could help him reach the whole world. At that stage, the purpose of his existence was the healing of the world, and therefore the possession of such large, expressive hands played an important role in addressing people. He gesticulated so actively during communication that one would think that he was Italian." Another photo of Funk shows Jackson holding a book in front of his face. This extremely personal shot was supposed to be an advertisement for the World Encyclopedia, which was distributed in American schools. "The art director gave me carte blanche to do anything, so I really wanted to push the boundaries of what was possible." Michael's eyes were his most striking feature, much more expressive than his legs. "I knew that I could capture his soul if his eyes were the center of the composition, and that's exactly what happened." But was Jackson really covering his face out of shyness? Maybe. But his shyness and introverted nature never got in the way of his ability to work with me as a photographer. Michael knew exactly what he wanted to achieve in his work. I think he knew this about 2 years before his death, and then he was simply confused by the wrong people, and he stopped understanding anything. This happened in preparation for the This Is It tour, for which Funk was supposed to be the photographer. Jackson was determined to play 50 shows in a row at the O2 Arena in London. But 20 days before the first show, he died of cardiac arrest, caused by acute intoxication from an overdose of anesthetic. "I hate talking about the last days," says Funk. "I will only say that it was destroyed by people who cared exclusively about their own financial interests. I can tell you that after the This Is It tour, he intended to do charity work and use his influence to improve the lives of mankind." In 2003, Jackson was charged with child molestation only to be acquitted later. The memory of this still angers Funk. All the accusations and all this shit that he had to go through. Let me ask you, what is the best way to destroy someone who is going to make a global positive change in the lives of children around the world? Of course, to discredit this person. Jackson's realization of the power of photography was probably best shown in the early 1990s, when he asked Funk to photograph him with Elizabeth Taylor and Nelson Mandela, who had just been released from prison. In the photo, which Funk calls the best of his career, all three are smiling contagiously. Mandela was so excited to meet Michael, Funk recalls. He brought his entire family with him. "The publicist informed me that there was no time for shooting, but Michael kicked everyone out and gave me the opportunity to take pictures. I didn't want to take boring ordinary shots, so I suggested that they jump on each other's backs and hug. Liz Taylor said to me, 'Harrison, you know I have a bad back.'" And Nelson added that he was too old for this, and joked that instead, he would have been happy to sit somewhere and put his legs up high. "I tried to capture the joy of this incredible moment." Funk then watched as the three of them retired to a conference room to discuss plans to end apartheid, improve women's rights, end AIDS, and end crime in Africa. He claims that Jackson was well aware of exactly how his photo with Mandela could play into the hands of the latter in the presidential election in South Africa. This photo was published by 400 newspapers or so. It was indeed very significant. The following year, Michael traveled to Africa to shoot the "They Don't Care About Us" video. He would do anything for Nelson. Michael and Liz generously invested in his election campaign. I think they got along so well because Michael was kind of like Mandela, but in music, in the sense that he also broke down a lot of barriers. Remember, Michael was one of the world's first black superstars. However, Jackson's image began to undergo rapid changes. Some critics accused the singer of being ashamed of his race and developing a dangerous obsession with plastic surgery. In a recent interview, producer Quincy Jones stated, "I just killed him for plastic surgery." He always made excuses and said that it was all because of some kind of his illness. Bullshit. He had problems with appearance because his father called him a freak and mocked him. What did you expect? Funk, however, insists that Jackson was in fact simply the victim of a brutal media campaign and suffered from a skin disease that destroyed his skin pigment, vitiligo. This claim was confirmed by Dr. Christopher Rogers, who performed the autopsy on Jackson's body. "This is all absolute nonsense," Funk says of these reports. He didn't want to look white or look for a way out. He was extremely proud of being black. "Michael suffered from a terrible skin disease that changed his appearance, and I had to take this into account as his photographer and adapt the lighting accordingly when shooting. I think the problem was that Michael desperately wanted to even out his skin tone. I didn't have Photoshop back then, so I did the lighting for Michael and used special techniques to make him look like $1 million. Funk, who has a myriad of stories about Jackson, speaks softly and with a New York accent, recalling 9 straight rides on the Space Mountain ride at Disneyland. Jackson tried to persuade Funk for the 10th time, but by that time the photographer was already sick, and his legs became cottony. They also regularly rode the Viking attraction installed at Jackson's ranch, Neverland. I sat across from him," recalls Funk, "and filmed him with my camera, and he told the technician who operated the attraction to lift us even higher, and again, and again. I yelled at Michael that I was going to lose my camera because of him. And he yelled back, 'I don't want to lose cookies.'" These cookies were in his shirt pocket. For all their joviality, Funk's most treasured memory of Jackson is a rather dark moment. He remembers sitting in the singer's home theater at the Neverland Ranch and watching the 1993 film, It's Got Love, a biopic about the abusive relationship between Ike and Tina Turner. And then Jackson began to cry. There was just a scene on the screen in which Ike hits Tina, and Michael shed a tear. I asked if he wanted to stop the screening, but he signaled to keep the film running. He squeezed my hand tightly. And at that moment, I felt his humanity very keenly. When the movie ended, we left the cinema and Michael suggested we go to the circuit. We played a rather tough game and seriously chased each other in these little cars. He was like a big kid. Jackson wasn't the only celebrity to reach out to Funk. The photographer is currently planning an exhibition of his work in London, which also includes images of David Bowie, Tina Turner and Amy Winehouse, although the King of Pop will no doubt be the main theme of the exhibition. This exhibition will be an interesting postscript to the exhibition on the wall, which is about to open at the National Portrait Gallery in London, where photographs and paintings of Jackson will be exhibited. Funk, who now lives in Los Angeles, is quite happy to hear that his photographs of Jackson are shaping his career. However, indulging in daydreams, he sometimes hears the voice of the singer, once again conjuring him, "Let's do magic."